Welcome to your new episode of The Startup Show. Today we are here in Berlin and I'm super excited to meet with Chiara, who is the Senior Investment Manager at the high-tech Gründerfonds here in Berlin. Welcome to The Startup Show.
Thank you. Hello.
Welcome to your new episode of The Startup Show. Today we are here in Berlin and I'm super excited to meet with Chiara, and we are here at the Bridgemaker offices again. Thank you very much. We can use your offices. Bridgemaker is a company builder here in Berlin, so thank you very much for that. But Chiara, today you are my guest, and I'm super excited that you are going to introduce us to the high-tech Gründerfonds here in Berlin. But Chiara, before we go into the VC that you are part of, maybe introduce yourself to my audience.
Hello, I'm Chiara. I'm originally a founder and entrepreneur and then switched side to venture capital. I'm almost 4 years with the high-tech Gründerfonds, now as a senior investment manager with an active portfolio of around 14 companies.
That's really impressive, but maybe you can give us some insights about like why you made that switch into venture capital.
In hindsight, I would say because I think that I'm a better investor than I'm an entrepreneur.
Okay, that's honest.
And it was more like the opportunities that arose, like when my startup didn't go the way that I wanted. I was looking for something new and I come from a finance background. And I was looking for something to combine my startup experience as well as my, giving input from my finance background. That's why I thought back then venture capital is a good option. And with the time, I realized that it's actually quite fitting to my skill.
Right. Maybe, many people are in the venture capital world. I'm curious to know what motivates you to be part of this venture capital ecosystem where you have the opportunity to invest and interact with so many entrepreneurs.
In short, it's the entrepreneurs, and it's similar to the goal of the entrepreneurs to build something great and giving your input in building something great. From the investor side, it's more or less the same aim as for a founder to build a great company, just from the other side of the table by giving money, by providing the network and the experiences you have done from previous investments. Mm-hmm.
I mean, when you look around Berlin, I think there's almost no seed round where the high-tech Gründerfonds is not involved. So maybe you can give us some background about the venture capital fund you're working for.
Absolutely. So high-tech Gründerfonds started in 2005, actually by an initiative of the government, back then Schröder, because there was no seed market existing in Germany, so not enough startups being funded in order for them to get like venture capital in a serious amount, series A, B, and most VCs correctly said that the seed stage is too risky, and this is why like they were hesitant to invest in it. So the state supported with a fund of around 300 million. From the beginning on, it was a public-private partnership where six corporates were involved, like Siemens, Bosch, Deutsche Telekom, and then the idea was to make at least 40 or around 40 seed investments per year and then see where this is going. And the first fund was doing well, so the second fund started 6 years later. Again, a public-private partnership, again 300 million, but 18 corporates joined.
Okay.
And now we are actually starting in Q4 our third fund. It's closed and we have more than 30 corporates on board. Around 100 million is coming from corporates and the rest from the government. So the part of the corporate involvement increased over time, which is great for us because we see it for our portfolio companies, a great link to get the German industry as customers, as partners, but maybe also as investors, or to at one point also sell your company to them. So with them, we try to close the cycle from seed to exit,
right,
and having a great growth story in between.
Sure. I mean, what would be interesting to me is to hear, like, why are these corporates not doing it themselves? I mean, like, when you look around Deutsche Telekom, they also have Hubraum. There are many incubators, many accelerators, you name them, that like do it themselves. Why do they decide to join the high-tech Gründerfonds?
As you said correctly, a lot of them have their venture capital arm, but some of them don't. For those who have a venture capital arm, still they rarely do seed investments because it's a very risky phase. So they have accelerators, which is like before us, which is more of a marketing PR thing. And then they have like maybe series A, B, but the seed stage is still too risky for them, which makes sense. This is the first point. Second point, a lot of these corporate VCs have a strategic angle. Yeah. So they just invest in areas which is relevant to their core business, whereas we, since we bundle so many corporates, don't have a strategic angle at all. So through us, they're getting a different deal flow and a different insight also to other industries, mm-hmm. which they wouldn't cover themselves. And even if our industries would be aligned, we still, since we are so active, a single corporate fund would never be as active as the HGGF. That's why our deal flow is very big, our portfolio is very big. We have currently more than 260 active portfolio companies. We did almost 500 investments. This is just a scale that a smaller VC or just a corporate single VC wouldn't achieve. And you have learnings with that, and you like tend to also invest in industries where others didn't thought of in the beginning to invest in.
I mean, you briefly mentioned deal flow. I mean, that's definitely interesting. How many startups do you look at every year? And the follow-on question is, how do you select?
Yeah. So we see a bit more than 2,000 companies per year.
Yeah.
And we invest, as I said, around 40. We invest in the hardware space, in the software space, and the life science space. Also for these spaces, the selection is a bit different, to be honest. So I'm in the software space, so I cover like my part. And for us, since it's the seed stage, there's not a lot there yet. Yeah. But some things you can prove, and the more you can prove at this stage, the better. For us, the team is very, very important because all the other stuff might change. The market might change. The product might change. Business model will definitely change. But the team should stay, or like maybe put additions to it as the startup grows. So we look at the track record of the team and how well like they will be able to execute on the idea. And the second part, which is important for us, is also that the technology, or that there's an innovative character, that it wouldn't be like so easy to copy, and like that we don't have the situation that tomorrow someone was with more capital would just like stamp on us and the startup is over. Obviously, also like the product is important and the market size, that you can build a big enough company out of it. But those are all things that come like secondary, I would say. And the first most important thing, as I said, is the team.
Right, right. But you know, like many times, like venture capital funds usually need numbers. Are they also like, let's say, revenue, you look at them, or it doesn't matter if it's pre-revenue?
It depends. So we also invest in pre-revenue, especially in the life science area. There's most of the time no revenue. For like marketplaces or a bit more low-tech stuff, we would like to see some numbers, but also in order like to see more of a proof that there are customers willing to pay for it. So in the B2B space, a lot of times if the product is not ready, we look if there are letter of intents from potential customers, just to see, okay, if this solution is being provided, there is a demand for that, and this is what you need to prove. This is like, again, a bit different always for B2B and B2C. At B2C, we also look at unit economics already and see whether they don't have to be positive yet, but which parts can I turn so that they will become to break even more positive.
Right. I mean, you just said your expertise is in software. So maybe from other companies you look at, what do you see any types of trends that we can see in the next couple of years that will become mainstream?
So I'm a big Bitcoin and blockchain fan, and I think this year's or latest next year when Bitcoin is becoming mainstream. In which areas we will see, but there will be definitely something. And just yesterday I realized that there is a Netflix documentary about Bitcoin, which was the proof for me that now it is the mainstream. but still, a lot of even fintech entrepreneurs don't own any Bitcoin. So it's not quite there yet, but I think this is a highly relevant trend. There is, as we see, like a lot of things happening in the AI AR, VR space, in the AI space. But most of the time when a VC says a trend is coming, the trend is already over. So the entrepreneurs are most of the time way closer to an innovation than the investors.
Right, but based on the pitch decks that you receive, so yeah. you get a nice sense. I mean, like now I spend a couple of months here in Berlin. I spend a couple of years in Israel. So now it's interesting for me to kind of like compare, let's say, Zurich to Berlin and Tel Aviv. Maybe you can give us some insights about the startup ecosystem here in Berlin and what you notice, and maybe even some critical thoughts about like what could be improved.
In the beginning, I want to say that it's incredible what happened in Berlin, even in the last 5 years, where I've been part of the ecosystem here. So it changed a lot, but we still don't have a history of an ecosystem like the Valley does, or also Tel Aviv does. So there is parts where we have to pick up, and there's some way to go. I think we have now, if you look at the VC map of Berlin around Mitte, you can walk like 200 meters and you meet have a new VC office. So I think this has also changed a lot. Yeah, so there's more capital in the city. A lot of the international investors come to Berlin to see if they, because there are great companies, not only in Berlin, but all over Germany. So this is also a great sign. I think the problem is what we haven't seen a lot is a lot of big companies that have made it. So the so-called unicorns, we don't have enough of them. We don't have any platforms. So what I mean with platform is like Facebook, Amazon, Google, they are like platforms. And there's no German-based platform. The last one that was built was SAP. In order like to be really relevant in the software space, kind of need to build such a platform. What we see actually, why this isn't happening is because entrepreneurs and investors sell their companies too early, which is also normal for a young ecosystem because you get the opportunity to make money and to exit after 5-6 years and still like as an entrepreneur make some good money, as an investor make money, but like to get to this like 20-30x you would have to get like do the another mile, and there's risk involved if this is happening. But also here with serial entrepreneurs and investors who have like this second, third fund, this becomes like more likely that this will happen soon.
Right. To wrap up the show, my favorite question of the show, it's a little bit of a biased question as an aspiring venture capitalist myself. I'd like to ask you, maybe you can give the students out there who would love to seed at some point, like be seated here as my guest, as an investment or, you know, VC manager kind of thing, what would you, you know, tell them to do as a tip starting off the career, right?
Follow a passion and solve a problem that you really think should be solved and can change something. This, I think, the most important advice that I can give, because only then you will be in it for the long haul and establish something great. And you can fail and try something else and find your strengths, but always combine it with your passion.
Mm-hmm. But let's say someone who really wants to become a venture capitalist.
Yeah.
is that the same? You would give the same advice?
You need to like it. So the challenge as a VC is that you don't have like your one baby. You start from seed to exit, but that is a lot of babies. So it's kind of a family that you build, and you need to nurture them and help them grow. You should be up for it. That it is your aim to like help a lot of companies grow and achieve their aims. So there needs to be a passion for that. The best way to get into the industry is definitely through networking. So meet VCs, become friends with them, but also entrepreneurs, so you like are of value to the VC.
Right. Okay, great. I think I'm off to a good start meeting a VC, entrepreneurs. So that's great. Thank you very much for your time, Kira. I really appreciate it. And all to my audience out there, thank you very much for tuning in today into this week's Startup Show episode. Thank you very much for your attention and have a great day. See you.